Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Killing for the Republic, Citizen Soldiers and the Roman Way of War by Steele Brand, narrated by Tom Parks. Preface. Why care about long-dead fighting farmers? In 146 BC, armies of the Roman Republic concluded their 118-year struggle for the Western Mediterranean when they breached the walls of their inveterate foe, Carthage. Roman troops slaughtered many of the citizens in brutal street fighting, enslaved those that remained, and leveled the city. The Roman commander, Scipio Aemilianus, watched Carthage as it was being destroyed and pondered its 700-year existence. Overcome with the magnitude of the moment, he wept. Scipio then turned to his friend, the historian Polybius, and remarked, "A glorious moment, Polybius, but I have a dread foreboding that someday the same doom will be pronounced on my own country." Later that year, across the Mediterranean near Corinth, another Roman army defeated the Achaean League. In the preceding half a century, Rome had repeatedly humiliated Alexander's successor kingdoms in Macedonia and Syria, and this battle terminated what freedoms remained for those Greek states caught in the middle. When the Romans entered Corinth, they enslaved its population and plundered its treasures. Uncouth soldiers supposedly played games atop famous works of art. In this fateful year, Rome became the master of the Mediterranean world. Even more remarkable was that they had done so with citizen soldiers. How did such a thing happen? What had made Rome so powerful? And if Scipio was right about the rise and fall of republics, does this have any meaning today? This book answers these questions by describing how Roman farmers were transformed into ambitious killers. Like many expansionist states throughout history, Rome instilled something violent and vicious in its soldiers, making them more effective than their opponents. But unlike the Assyrians, Persians, Macedonians, and other imperial peoples of history, the Romans did so with part-timers. They perfected civic militarism in a way no other civilization ever has. The Roman Republic was born in a chaotic world where competing city-states, kingdoms, and empires sought to dominate or annihilate their neighbors. By the end of the 4th century BC, it had outstripped its neighboring Italian city-states and leagues by creating the best constitution with the deadliest citizen soldiers. In the 3rd century, Rome defeated the multi-talented mercenaries of monarchic adventurers like Pyrrhus and commercial republics like Carthage. In the 2nd century, Rome looked east and distinguished itself from the Hellenistic kingdoms that flourished in the wake of Alexander's death. In the Roman mind, these monarchies had done away with the republicanism of city-states such as Athens and Sparta, and the Macedonian war machine now threatened liberty and justice in the West. Rome shocked the Mediterranean world by defeating the heirs of Alexander one by one and then taking over their domains. This is the story of how they did it and why it still matters. Rome's capacity for winning wars in this struggle to survive is well known, but the legacy of how it won its wars through republican virtues is disappearing. Today, intellectuals often describe the Roman Republic as an undemocratic, militaristic precursor to the more important empire that would follow. Postmodernists decry the colonialism, imperialism, and patriarchy of ancient Rome. And younger generations often sympathize with the titanic personalities that orchestrated the Republic's collapse. Characters like Pompey, Caesar, and Antony are often seen as victims of their circumstances who were just trying to get ahead in an amoral world. Each of these critiques has a point, but they undervalue the circumstances of Rome's uniqueness as the finest ancient republic. They also miss the singular genius of Rome's republican spirit, which earned it the right to dominate the Mediterranean in the last centuries before Christ. This same spirit eventually inspired the rebirth of republicanism for future generations in places like Florence, Venice, Britain, and the United States. With the limited sources remaining, we do not know all the qualities of Rome's neighbors, but we do know what ancient authors said made Rome distinctive. Historians like Polybius, Livy, and Dionysius argue that the Romans created the best republican system in the most capable federation of the ancient world. Roman political ingenuity was matched by capable military institutions, which marshaled vast numbers of men, absorbed defeats in the field, adapted technologies from neighbors, and allowed the best commanders and troops to achieve victory in the long run. Yet, Roman institutions were imperfect and would have achieved little had they not rested on a resilient culture that inculcated civic virtues like honor, piety, loyalty to patrons and family, hard work, and the rugged independence inherent in small-holding farmers. Rome survived by unifying disparate political elements under constitutional orders that relied on average citizens with agricultural lifestyles. Farming may have been ubiquitous in the ancient world, but politically empowered farmer citizens were not, and military proficient farmer citizen soldiers were rarer still. These citizens took ownership of their republic to such lengths that they heartily sacrificed themselves and their enemies on the altar of republican glory. This was the Roman way of war. The history of Rome's citizen soldiers has implications for the United States in the 21st century. Rome was maintained by different values and defended by different strengths than modern republics. The Roman Republican embodied physical interaction with the soil, resistance to tyranny, and personal sacrifice for the public good. This civic mode of being is increasingly foreign today. Roman citizens were more aware of the land and the climate. They were more self-reliant and leery of concentrated power. They were more in tune with the sacrifices of war. In a modern world beset by environmental challenges, military conflicts waged by technocrats, professionals, and drones, and large bureaucratic nation-states where average citizens offer little participation in politics, especially in the ways they authorize and fight wars, the story of the ancient republican is more important than ever before. Roman civic militarism. As a military history of Roman citizen armies, this book examines the relationship between the republican spirit and the citizen soldier, analyzes how this spirit motivated men on the battlefield, and explains why those concerned about the trajectory of their own republicanism should care about Roman warfare. I weave cultural ideologies into a broader tapestry of the military culture that includes practical considerations such as Mediterranean geopolitics, strategic goals, and technological and tactical innovations. I outline the general history, but then pause for a deeper examination of specific battles, explaining how the constitutional and cultural evolution of Rome affected battlefield tactics at the battles of Sentinum, New Carthage, Pydna, Mutina, and Philippi. As a political and cultural history, this book also engages the recent debates on the nature of Roman militarism, republicanism, and federalism. During its republican era, Rome manifested three overarching themes conducive to citizen armies: liberty, divided sovereignty, and participatory citizenship. These terms had different meanings than they do now and can be briefly defined here. Liberty was the absence of slavery and foreign domination. Divided sovereignty was the constitutional commitment to a degree of balancing between the three pure forms of government, as well as the incorporation of federated levels of sovereignty at the familial and local level. Participatory citizenship was the moral foundation of society that demanded personal character, loyalty to class and family, piety, and civic-mindedness. When Rome sought to defend and extend its power, it applied these republican tenets in its martial institutions. Political leadership used oratory in public spaces to condemn enemies as threats to liberty. Citizens then mustered to defend the state from domestic or external foes. Political norms and institutions created an environment where councils managed diplomacy, statesmen became commanders, treaties furnished allies, and citizens authorized warfare. The foundational element was civic virtue. Religious rituals, civic monuments, an agrarian lifestyle, family honor, and communal glory habituated citizens to the idea of fulfilling their duty. When troops finally faced their enemy on the field of battle, their values, institutions, and upbringing had suitably prepared them for the rigors and horrors of war. Civic militarism was self-defense writ large for the state, with each citizen waging war on behalf of the community. It cultivated all the necessary martial values so that ordinary citizens could be prepared for war. From birth, a citizen's peers, family members, religious leaders, and magistrates actively instilled martial virtues such as initiative, strength, discipline, persistence, courage, and loyalty. By the time he had grown into a man, the Roman citizen was expected to appreciate and defend agrarian values, civic participation, family honor, and the glory that could be achieved in defending the community. I am prone to agree with John Keegan that war embraces much more than politics, that it is always an expression of culture, often a determinant of cultural forms, in some societies, the culture itself. The sword of the state can force a man to march onto the battlefield. But when fleeing that same battlefield will save his life, something deeper often obliges him to stay. My choice of Rome is not intended to deny the importance of Hellenic novelties in constitutionalism and citizen soldiering. However, it is important to note that most ancient authors, such as Plato, Aristotle, Polybius, and Plutarch, critiqued the political institutions of the Hellenic states. Athens was too democratic. Sparta was too restrictive. Thebes was too ephemeral. As I explain in the prologue, early Americans believed the best insights stemmed from Rome. And this is an important factor in why the historical lessons from the Roman Republic are incredibly valuable for the United States and other modern republics of the Western Hemisphere. In the mid-4th century, Rome expanded beyond city-states into a federation of Italian states. This federation was substantially stronger than the Greek leagues and more heavy-handed than most modern federations. Nonetheless, Rome's federal arrangement was the best alternative to other masters. It was organic, meaning it relied on pre-existing institutions and political structures. This sort of republicanism, both within the citizens' republic and the broader federation, stood in opposition to the Spartan model and even to a certain extent the Athenian, where local and family structures were unnaturally rearranged so that they could not challenge the polis. Rome placed a greater emphasis on mixed government, a mixture of monarchic, aristocratic, and democratic institutions. It slowly developed a complex version of mixed government that divided political sovereignty during the floruit of its citizen armies. This mixed government tended to favor the aristocracy, but it still distributed sovereignty to monarchic and democratic elements. Athens, on the other hand, traded its mid-5th century model of mixed government for a meteoric democracy. Constitutionalism and participatory government in the Hellenic world achieved marvelous feats in philosophy and the arts, and their citizen armies guaranteed a Greece free from Persian rule. However, Hellenic political and military culture also caused the disastrous century from the beginnings of the Peloponnesian War to the conquest by Philip. What Hellenic culture had accomplished the century before? It sacrificed in internecine wars that led to the eventual domination of Macedon. Rome, on the other hand, achieved enough unity to gradually build an empire. The political and military machinery of Rome was later synthesized with Greek intellectual culture and Christian philosophy to breathe life into what became the West. This breath of life spawned important religious, institutional, and legal contributions to human civilization. It should never be forgotten that this was only the case because Roman citizen soldiers fought for the dominance of Rome. Civic militarism's meaning today. In this volume, I reconstruct the story of the citizen soldier on the field of battle. There is no shortage of books explaining Rome's rise and Rome's republicanism, but as of yet, no one has told the story of how Rome created the best citizen soldiers in history and how these citizen soldiers then conquered the world. My own interest in this phenomenon is practical as well as scholarly. I served in the United States Army as an intelligence officer from 2009 to 2013, which included a 2012 combat tour to Afghanistan. I wanted to understand military history from the perspective of the common soldier, so I joined the Army after defending my dissertation. As a soldier, I examined my Army experiences with the lens of an academic, and after I was discharged, I approached Roman military history with the lens of a practitioner. One thing I discovered was that modern republics often misidentify their troops as citizen soldiers. Active duty soldiers are constantly referred to by this term, but they are nothing like the citizen soldier of the Roman Republic. They also do not resemble the American Minutemen or the militias of the early United States a mere 2 centuries ago. Instead, they are much closer to the Spartan soldier-citizen, or even the warrior classes of the Persian Empire or the Hellenistic kingdoms. I clarify what the citizen soldier is by defining him and describing his historical origins. The latter half of the book reconstructs some of the most important battles fought by Rome, providing momentary glimpses of the norms and beliefs for which citizen soldiers fought. I identify what drove them forward at the crucial moment, the moment, as much as any moment can, when cultural dominance was on the tipping point. The battles have been chosen because of their exceptional character in portraying the ethos of the combatants. I explain the heritage of the citizen soldier for a culture that has forgotten who he is and why he fights. I also reflect on the modern analogies to Rome. The best ancient historians are conversant in the latest research of their subdisciplines, but they also explain why their research is relevant. Eric Klein recently described the Bronze Age collapse in light of today's global wars and climate crisis. Josiah Ober offers the latest research on Athens democracy to provide insights for modern democracies promoting their values abroad. Arthur Eckstein describes Rome's rise in terms of modern international relations theories. Other recent works apply the insights of ancient history to modern strategy, politics, civil-military relations, and leadership. Historical analogies are a tricky business, but modern nation-states, such as the United States, have already demonstrated a penchant for them. The presence of Gaius and Papinian in the U.S. House chamber, neoclassical architecture such as the Capitol, the text and iconography on currency, and geographical sites named Tiber Creek in Washington, D.C., are merely the tip of the iceberg when it comes to how the United States created its own allusions to Rome. The analogies are already there, but they deserve more reflection. This is especially important for the United States, which was itself conceived as a Roman-style agrarian republic with a mixed government and militias. America is in the midst of a transition that is filled with temptations toward political virtue and vice. Citizens would do well to remember Polybius' cycles of government, which are indebted to the political treatises of Plato and Aristotle. I do not follow them precisely, but I do accept the classical notion that all republics are born, mature, decline, and then perish. This historical guarantee is as certain as the human biological cycle. It was true with Rome, and it is true of modern republics. At the center of this life cycle are civil-military relations, because the soul of any state is most clearly defined when it decides what it is willing to kill and die for. There is a great deal of discontinuity between the civil-military relations of an ancient and a modern republic. Barbarian invasions, systems collapses, renaissances, reformations, scientific revolutions, industrial revolutions, nuclear bombs, and the age of the computer all separate America from its model. Yet, people still fight for resources, land, and prestige. They still dream of the ideal political society and then kill each other in their attempts to achieve it. Liberty is still a goal and tyranny decried. Peace is still sought, yet war is as prevalent as ever. This work examines the successes and failures of individual citizens, both exceptional and average, who demonstrated great character or great folly. It gives modern republicans much to contemplate by explaining how their ancient counterparts dreamed, how they achieved their dreams, and how they destroyed their achievements with their own hands. The prologue explains the special favor Rome and its citizen soldiers have enjoyed in modern republics, especially the United States. Classical city-states and empires from throughout the Mediterranean, including Sparta, Athens, Persia, Alexander and his heirs, Carthage and the Greek leagues, have been referenced by generations of Americans. But the Roman preference for agrarian republicanism and citizen soldiering made it the most revered and the most emulated. This fact makes knowledge of Rome's republican warfare a modern necessity. Part 1 describes the ancient republican citizen. Chapter 1 introduces the life and priorities of the citizen soldier. Life as a hard-working, independent farmer may have made him a sturdier soldier, but it also complicated his function as a soldier. Citizen armies balanced a tension between the peaceful activities of citizens and the martial nature of soldiering. Chapter 2 describes the citizen soldier's republic. Republic is a term that means many things to many people, so I clarify how the Roman Republic evolved and how it was unique. Roman republicanism was managed by an elite nobility of commanders, but it was defended by the loyalty of small holding farmer citizen soldiers with a stake in the state. The farmer understood the earth that gave him his home and his living and provided for his family. The citizen created and existed in the society of his fellows. The soldier was willing to kill for these things. Parts 2 through 4 tell the history of Rome's republican wars. Each chapter opens by referencing how the stages in Rome's republican life cycle are relevant today. Part 2 describes the formation of Rome's citizen-soldier ethos. Chapter 3 explores the stories associated with Rome's birth as a city-state governed by kings and how Roman militarism evolved into a revolutionary culture. Rome's citizen soldiers emerged in a distant and murky past that was later idealized in order to define the character of the virtuous commander and citizen soldier. Chapter 4 describes the first 2 centuries after the expulsion of the kings, as the new republic attempted to survive in a multipolar anarchy. It explores the meaning of Rome's revolution and how Rome distinguished itself by using civic militarism to build a federation in central Italy. Rome nearly succumbed to internal autocrats attempting to resurrect the monarchy at the same time that external foes were set on obliterating Roman citizens and seizing their lands. Marauding Gauls from the north, tribal peoples from the Apennines and neighboring city-states all threatened Rome. It survived by finding political solutions that increased its manpower base and by adapting tactics and weapons suited to each of its foes. Part 3 describes the triumph of Roman armies as they conquered the Mediterranean world. Chapters 5, 6, and 7 describe Rome's incredible expansion in the 3rd and 2nd centuries. Each chapter focuses on a particular battle that highlights the political convictions, military ethos, and innovative tactics of Roman commanders and common soldiers. Chapter 5 describes the breakout years of the Republic. Rome's decisive victory at Sentinum in the 3rd Samnite War paved the way for Rome's control of Italy. Sentinum was a close-run battle that displayed the capabilities of Rome's nascent, manipular legions in the hands of 2 dissimilar commanders intent on outshining the other. Chapter 6 narrates Rome's greatest trial. In the 3rd century, Rome faced off against its greatest nemesis, Carthage, and the tactical genius, Hannibal. The Republic seemed on the brink of disaster after several devastating defeats in the Second Punic War, but it was able to triumph through loyal allies, an unending supply of soldiers and commanders, and the equally great tactician Scipio Africanus. The end result was Roman dominance in the Western Mediterranean. Chapter 7 explains how unprecedented success tested the legendary flexibility of Roman republicanism. Rome achieved more incredible victories when it defeated Alexander's successor kingdoms in the east in the 2nd century. The Battle of Pydna in 168 showcased the tactical independence and superiority of Rome's citizen soldiers against Macedonian phalangites. Part 4 covers the last chaotic century of the Republic. Chapter 8 explains how Rome's expansion raised the political stakes at home. The Republic's final century was punctuated by chaos and civil war as it tried to adjust its constitution to meet growing needs. Rome achieved the high point of military success, was able to defeat the toughest armies in battle, and reached its farthest territorial limits. However, Rome itself was becoming a literal battleground. Several decades of colorful personalities, from the Gracchi brothers to Marius and Sulla, and from Pompey to Julius Caesar, were using the changing world of the empire to further their own agendas at the expense of the Republic. mob violence, assassinations, and mutinies proliferated, and rogue commanders vied for legitimacy as the Republic veered out of control. But despite what many moderns think, the end was not inevitable. The greatest articulator of Roman republicanism, indeed the triumphal culmination of all classical republican thought, was Cicero, who flourished in these years. In the wake of Caesar's assassination, Cicero united the Republic into one final coalition to crush Mark Antony. Cicero's last great political triumph resulted in a military victory at Mutina. But the battle demonstrated how Rome's citizen soldiers were now a dangerous asset that was already wrecking the Republic. Chapter 9 explores the sudden and simultaneous end of Rome's republicanism and Roman citizen soldiers. In an unpredictable flurry of events over 18 months, the Republic descended from near victory to total defeat. Up until the final moments in the Battle of Philippi, Rome's fate hung in the balance as it teetered between victory for the autocratic heirs of Caesar and for his republican assassins. Both sides relied on the massive and indomitable manpower of citizen soldiers, but only a republican victory would have kept them and their constitution in existence. In the end, Rome's citizen soldiers committed mass fratricide. The republicans lost, and the way was cleared for the professional armies of an emperor. The epilogue explains how the Republic's ideal of citizen soldiers perished shortly after its greatest exponent. It closes the work with a comparison of Horace and Livy, two Republicans who were co-opted into the new imperial regime. Both kept alive the shadows of republicanism and citizen armies, one by gazing nostalgically backward and the other by appropriating its themes. Their insights simultaneously buttressed and challenged Augustus' new world order, and they raise some interesting questions for Republicans then and now. Unless otherwise noted, all translations from classical sources in the text come from the editions that make up the Loeb Classical Library. Prologue: The Roman and American Republics. The American revolutionaries and framers studied Roman history for insights on law, statesmanship, military command, and constitutional institutions. They seemed to have heeded the challenge of the Greek historian Polybius in his histories about Rome's unprecedented rise as the first republic to rule the world. For who is so worthless or indolent as not to wish to know by what means and under what system of polity the Romans succeeded in subjecting nearly the whole inhabited world to their sole government, a thing unique in history? Early Americans would not allow Polybius' ghost to accuse them of either worthlessness or indolence. Take the U.S. Capitol, for example, which was begun at the end of the 18th century. The building is replete with references to the classical world, from its architecture to its numerous portraits, paintings, busts, statues, reliefs, frescoes, murals, and sculptures. Some of the features, like the Pantheon-inspired dome, Corinthian columns, numerous eagles and fasces, the bundle of rods symbolizing power, and mythical figures like the justice relief in the old Supreme Court chamber, the Liberty and the Eagle statue in Statuary Hall, and the Peace and War statues in the niches outside the east entrance specifically channel ancient Rome. War is simply Mars dressed as a gladius and scutum-toting Roman soldier. The references to Rome were both in vogue and intentional. Neoclassical art and architecture were the rage across Europe and the Americas in the 18th and 19th centuries. The capital's most famous painter and fresco worker, Constantino Brumidi, was born in Rome and trained amid the ancient glories of the city. Other artists used Roman models or completed their works in Rome. The figures from the Progress of Civilization pediment, for example, were modeled in Rome in 1854. The title of one book on the capital, American Pantheon, even makes the case. The American founders were also educated in the classical tradition and wanted to pay homage to Greek and Roman ideals such as republicanism, the rule of law, democracy, free speech, citizen soldiering, and civic virtue. They first conceived the capital in the 1790s, and its current footprint was completed by the 1860s. During those 8 decades, it underwent substantial changes, and it remains an evolving building to the current day. Its ongoing alterations reflect the shifting civic sentiments of the American people. The Capitol's design and decoration were intended to capture the civic and the civil-religious idealization of what Americans believed their growing republic embodied. American republicanism would have a different meaning and a different majesty from its European progenitors. Here, we explore how Rome was adopted as the most important classical model for Americans, and then conclude with the U.S. Capitol's most enduring reminder of the Roman Republic, its fighting farmers. Classical models and anti-models. A classical education was in fashion on the continent in the 17th and 18th centuries, but a number of early Americans questioned whether it was worthwhile. William Penn, for example, believed an education should focus on more practical skills. They also feared, in the words of John Wilson, the ignorance, lewdness, and profanity that would stem from studying those ancient heathens. Benjamin Rush, a signer of the Declaration and Philadelphia physician, campaigned against classical education for these reasons, and he also believed it was inherently elitist. Even the polymaths Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin had their doubts. Franklin asserted that Americans should look within themselves to find the virtue and knowledge that would enable them to carve out a new republic unfettered by the faults of Europe's past. By the early 19th century, this view was increasingly prevalent, as captured by Tocqueville. Political architects in the New World, he suggests in Democracy in America, should not be too keen on applying ancient models. When I compare the Greek and Roman republics to these republics of America, the manuscript library of the first and their coarse populace, to the 1,000 newspapers that crisscross the second, and to the enlightened people that inhabit the republics of America, when I then think of all the efforts that are still made to judge the one with the aid of the others, and to foresee what will happen today by what happened 2,000 years ago, I am tempted to burn my books in order to apply only new ideas to a social state so new. Despite Jefferson and Franklin's reservations and Tocqueville's blustering, no one actually burned their books. Most still believed a classical education would help the best men create the best sort of republic. Critics such as Rush still remarked that the classics contained much useful knowledge, and Franklin and Jefferson saw the sense of civics, aesthetics, and virtue that a classical education could inspire. Even Tocqueville was not yet comfortable jettisoning a classical education. He saw a great deal of discontinuity between ancient and modern republics, but he still thought that reading Greek and Latin would foster freedom and democracy in modern republics. The ancient republics, he notes, have special qualities that can serve marvelously to counterbalance our particular defects. The classically educated American founders quote liberally from the histories of Greece and Rome, but they give preference to Rome for two reasons. First, Roman republicanism was seen as the culmination of that which was best from the classical world. Second, Rome was believed to have outdone the Hellenes in its republicanism. Although oligarchic, or as John Adams styles early Rome, an aristocratical republic, Rome's virtues as a pastoral, mixed government republic were unsurpassed in the classical world. Two ancient authors in particular lent credence to these views, Polybius and Plutarch. Polybius surveys the best constitutions of the Mediterranean in Book 6 of his Histories. He finds much to praise in Carthage, Sparta, and Rome was the best of these. Democracies like Athens and Thebes, on the other hand, modeled failure better than success. The primary obstacle to Athenian and Carthaginian virtue was their nature as commercial, seafaring republics. Polybius treats the Roman Republic's mixed constitution at length, but he believed its agricultural economic system was just as important. Roman farmers were insulated from the corrupting effects of trade, and their simplicity made them pious citizens who valued virtue over profit. They also made sturdier soldiers. Polybius argues that Rome's victories over Carthage were due, in no small measure, to its pastoralism. From the field of Greek and Roman history, Plutarch would pluck out the best and worst statesmen as character studies for his parallel lives. His biographies were famous in the ancient world and had become useful in the early modern period. English versions of his lives, especially John Dryden's 17th-century translation, were widely used by the 18th-century founders. Plutarch compares Greek and Roman statesmen, with Romans usually earning more of his favor. Roman republicans are the best models of patriotism, virtue, and leadership. Rome's leaders during the Republic, such as Camillus, Fabius, Maximus, Aemilius Paulus, Marcellus, Cato the Elder, Flaminius, and Cato the Younger, are the heroes of Plutarch. Greek republicans win the same praise from Plutarch, but there are fewer here. Pericles, for example, is finer in certain respects than Fabius Maximus, and Philopoemen is more noble than his Roman counterpart Flaminius. The tragic Athenian statesman Phocion is one of Plutarch's favorites. However, Hellenic statesmen like Alcibiades and Nicias and Hellenistic autocrats like Pyrrhus are complex examples of both virtuous and vicious traits. Coriolanus is the only Roman in this mold until Plutarch's biographies about the fall of the Republic. The Athenian democracy itself is often a villain in his biographies. The worst villains are those men responsible for the destruction of republicanism, like Marius, Sulla, and Mark Antony. The founders essentially adopted the thinking of Polybius and Plutarch. Sparta was to be preferred to Athens, which was exceedingly problematic, but Rome was even better than Sparta. Whether or not Polybius' estimation of the ancient republics was right, the founders still found his articulation of Roman mixed government convincing. John Adams thought Polybius' wisdom was indispensable for modern republics, especially America's. In his defense, he explains, "I wish to assemble together the opinions and reasonings of philosophers, politicians, and historians who have taken the most extensive views of men and societies, whose characters are deservedly revered, and whose writings were in the contemplation of those who framed the American constitutions. It will not be contested that all these characters are united in Polybius. As a civic republican, advocate of checks and balances, and federalist, Adams could find no better model for America's own mixed government than the one outlined by Polybius for Rome. He concludes his chapter titled Ancient Democratical Republics with a history of the Roman Republic through the time of Polybius, declaring that this commonwealth, by the splendor of its actions, the extent of its empire, the wisdom of its councils, the talents, integrity, and courage of a multitude of characters, exhibits the fairest prospect of our species, and is the most signal example, excepting England, of the wisdom and utility of a mixture of the three powers in a commonwealth. Thomas Jefferson may have been Adams' political rival and philosophical opposite in American political thought, but he still found much to admire about Rome. His affinity for the Roman Republic grew out of his love of farming and the virtues of agricultural life. Jefferson led those Americans, particularly the Democratic Republicans, who believed the United States was uniquely blessed with abundant land, and that this land would provide the setting for America's citizenry of Virgilian farmers. Incidentally, this was one of the key motivators for Jefferson's uncharacteristically unconstitutional move to secure the Louisiana Purchase, which guaranteed more farmland for America's pastoral republic. Like the Greek city-states in the 5th century, Rome relied on farmers to fight its wars. This started to change in the 2nd century, and Plutarch pins the blame for the Republic's demise on Marius' reforms that professionalized the army around 100 BC, although this process was actually more complicated than he allows. Benjamin Rush agrees with Plutarch and other founders who cite Marius and Sulla as the two principal villains who used corruption and money to end the virtue and austerity of the Roman Republic. Rome's republican history was seen as a golden age ruined by Plutarch's villains. All that was best of the classical world was found in the history of pre-imperial Rome. For the founding generation, the Roman Republic was virtuous. The later Roman Empire was decadent, aggressive, and evil. Common anti-models from the classical world were the Roman emperors, Roman militarism, and the statesmen that caused the collapse of the Roman Republic. Philip and Alexander were comparable anti-models from Greek history. Greek democracy as a whole was just as problematic. Athens was the easiest target when it came to historical examples of ambitious demagogues and reckless assemblies. Rome may have been the best of the ancient world, but it was not flawless in the eyes of the founders. Even during the Republic, Rome's hamartia was its overbearing federalism and militarism, twin evils that colonial Americans believed themselves to be chafing under in the modern equivalent of the overbearing colonial mistress, Britain. The Rome that expanded and acquired colonies became more and more of the tyrannical mistress that Americans saw in Britain. Fisher Ames, a leading Federalist and member of the first United States Congress, articulated some of these problems. He used both Greek and Roman statesmen for pen names, from Lucius Junius Brutus and Camillus to Phocion. It is telling, however, that Brutus and Camillus come from the virtuous beginnings of Rome, whereas Phocion is from Athens' declining days in the 4th century. Although Ames admired Rome, its militarism troubled him. There was scarcely one of the 1,200 years that Rome subsisted that her dominion was not odious and dangerous to her neighbors. Post-colonial scholars should appreciate Ames' portrayal of Rome as a voracious conqueror, a polity for whom there was but one trade, and that was war. All were soldiers. Ames critiques post-revolutionary France as modeling the militaristic Romans, but he clarifies that they more closely resembled the Romans after they were corrupted and had lost their liberty. Like most of the founding generation, Ames believed that the Roman Republic was a model of virtue, mixed government, and liberty, if only for themselves, but that this was ultimately destroyed by a combination of corruption and militarism. Rome's conquests were its idol, and Ames feared that America would be tempted by the equally destructive vice of avarice. Sparta was another favorite model of a mixed constitution, but its tyrannical rule over its neighbors was even worse than Rome's. Ames follows Alcibiades and quips that the oppressive and tyrannical nature of the Spartan constitution made them welcome death in battle. He also found Sparta problematic as a constitutional model because, in his view, it was only a military aristocracy propped up by slave labor. Greek confederations were seen as less tyrannical than Rome's federation. However, their decentralized nature was cited as a culprit in the tumultuous history of the Greek city-states. The Amphictyonic, Achaean, and Lucian leagues were discussed at length in the constitutional debates of the late 1780s. In Federalist 4, John Jay uses the failure of the Greek confederacies as an example of what would happen should America fail to unite under a stronger constitution. Madison, or possibly Hamilton, agrees in Federalist 18, which reads like a history treatise on the confederations of ancient Greece. The Greek city-states may have eked out successes against the Persians in the 5th century, but their confederations could not keep the Greek city-states from destroying one another in the Peloponnesian War and its aftermath, nor did they withstand the Macedonian menace. The ineffectual leagues were put out of their misery by Rome. The Hellenes' ancient liberty was torn into pieces, and such imbecility and distraction introduced that the arms of Rome found little difficulty in completing the ruin. Madison concludes by stating that this history offered a warning that the new constitution must be accepted, lest America suffer a similar fate. A number of American thinkers followed ancient authors like Plato, Aristotle, Polybius, and Plutarch, and critiqued the political history of the Hellenic states. At the Federal Convention of 1787, members added force to their arguments by citing this history. Madison, Hamilton, and Georgia delegate William Pierce used Athens as a historical example to argue against democracy. In Federalist 14, Madison critiques the turbulent democracies of ancient Greece and modern Italy. He quips in Federalist 55 that, had every Athenian citizen been a Socrates, every Athenian assembly would still have been a mob. Hamilton concurs in Federalist 9. It is impossible to read the history of the petty republics of Greece and modern Italy without feeling sensations of horror and disgust at the distractions with which they were continually agitated, and at the rapid success of revolution by which they were kept perpetually vibrating between the extremes of tyranny and anarchy. In Federalist 63, Madison, or Hamilton possibly, uses Athens as the whipping boy again, citing it as an example of the popular government that was devoid of so provident a safeguard against the tyranny of their own passions. He found better examples in Sparta, Carthage, and Rome, which all contained senates. Jennifer Tolbert Roberts investigates Athens' historical reputation in Athens on Trial, and concludes that, for the framers of the American Constitution, the story of Athens was the story of failure. Modern Americans may look at the ancient model of democracy to derive some valuable lessons, but the idea that it has insights to offer contrasts strikingly with the conviction of America's founders that what little Athens had to teach was entirely of the negative variety. Even the anti-federalists with their democratic tendencies were reluctant to use Athens as a model. The same could not be said of Rome. Roberts concludes, The Romans fared somewhat better, most obviously in the shaping and naming of the Senate and in the adoption of Roman mottos and catchwords, such as E pluribus unum and novus ordu seclorum. Despite the rejection of Athenian-style democracy, the classical ideal of republican government served as an important legitimizing tool for American constitutionalists seeking to demonstrate the ancient pedigree of accountable and non-monarchic governments. Roman patriotism, courage, and pastoralism were lauded as the best virtues of the classical world. Rome's constitutional features were also the most praiseworthy. The constitutions of Athens, Sparta, Carthage, Thebes, Crete, and Rome provided source materials for the founders when they were discussing the American Constitution and early American lawmaking. But the Roman Constitution was the most influential. A bicameral legislature, the Senate and its advise and consent role, property qualifications, congressional war authorization, Rome's more robust federalism, age requirements for office holders, term limits, and of course, the vast corpus of Roman law and Latin legal terminology made Rome the uncontested classical favorite for the art and science of American republicanism. Republics of the Fighting Farmer. The founders' use of their classical education was not always a sophisticated affair. Like adolescent boys adulating one another as superheroes, the founders likened one another to classical heroes. Thomas Jefferson compared John Adams to Themistocles, although Adams preferred Cicero for himself. James Wilson adored Cicero as well. Abigail Adams compared Madison's future vice president, Elbridge Gerry, to Cato. And George Washington was often compared to Fabius Maximus. An even more popular parallel for Washington was Cincinnatus. Cincinnatus was given special attention in the U.S. Capitol when Brumidi painted his first mural, The Calling of Cincinnatus from the Plow, in the House Agricultural Committee Room. The subject was the exiled Roman commander Cincinnatus, who was farming his small plot of land when he was summoned by the Roman people to rescue the state from invaders. Instead of maintaining his power, however, he surrendered it and returned to his farm. Cincinnatus did all this in 16 days. It took Brumidi much longer to recreate the scene in paint from January to March 1855. The Cincinnatus anecdote was a powerful one during the American Revolution, and Brumidi acknowledged Cincinnatus' exemplarity by painting The Calling of Putnam from the Plow to the Revolution across from him in the same room. The comparison of generals such as Washington and Putnam to Cincinnatus represented one of the most important analogies to ancient Rome. Preserved for future generations in the Capitol building, stories like this were meant to instruct lawgivers and citizens with regard to their civic ideals. In the traditional history of early Rome, Cincinnatus was part of the second generation of leaders that emerged after the Romans ejected their kings. His accomplishments in securing domestic peace were as important as his valor in war. Another anecdote that looks suspiciously like a doublet has him once again summoned to take command of the Roman state, put down a monarchic conspiracy, and restore domestic peace. Washington, like Cincinnatus, was the master of both war and peace. This ancient narrative was invaluable to American revolutionaries. They cast their cause as noble as that of the self-denying Cincinnatus. Americans, like their idealized Romans, envisioned themselves as innocent, hard-working farmers forced to offer their lives by taking up arms in defense of liberty. 18th-century Americans were justified in their praise of Cincinnatus because they believed that the best polity was a republic based on pastoral virtues. They also believed that citizens should be willing to fight for it. America's economy will never again be as agricultural as it was during the founding. And even at that time, the amount of industry and trade in America surpassed that of Athens and Carthage. Nonetheless, the U.S. Capitol once again captures how America perceived itself as the new Rome. The rotunda's frieze of American history, painted by Brumidi and Filippo Costagini, valorizes the pastoral virtues of early Americans. The fresco begins with Spanish colonization in all its monarchic grandeur. Columbus dazzles the natives, and Cortez and Pizarro conquer them. De Soto is buried ceremoniously. The painting portrays them as the dashing conquistadors in search of riches and glory with Catholic missionaries in tow. The Spaniards are followed by the fantastic romantic tale of John Smith and Pocahontas, which was probably just too saucy to ignore. The next scenes portray what English colonization was supposed to embody. The Pilgrims piously land at Plymouth in 1620. Next, Penn treats with the Indians in 1682. New England is colonized in the next panel, and the final colonial scene is of Governor Oglethorpe treating with the Indians in 1732. The frescoes are magnificent, but the people in them are not. Compared to those portrayed in the Spanish frescoes, they are positively prosaic. The Pilgrims are simply clothed, lacking the armor and mounts of the Spanish. They are praying or working with chests and bundles of sticks and tools. The Colonization of New England panel shows the colonists hard at work, chopping wood, installing beams, and erecting buildings. The point is simple here. The English colonists that settled the 13 colonies came to farm, work, and build a new life. The colonists in the Penn and Oglethorpe panels are also clothed plainly when they treat with the Indians. Unlike the Spanish panels, these two panels show the colonists on equal terms with the Indians. They did not come as conquerors, but as peacemakers. The contrasts may be overstated, but they nonetheless represent the peaceful pastoralism Americans wanted to remember about their history. Hard work, frugality, and austerity characterized the colonists as they had characterized the ancient republicans millennia ago. The rotunda painting is only one of the many pastoral scenes throughout the Capitol. Others include the apotheosis of democracy sculpture in the House pediment, the calling of Putnam from the plow to the revolution, the bottom scenes of the Senate bronze doors, the Senate's east entry, the progress of civilization sculpture in the Senate pediment, the embarkation of the pilgrims at Delft Haven hanging in the rotunda, and agriculture, the top scene of the right valve in the Amateus bronze doors. Another Republican principle on display was the colonists' civic militarism. If pastoral republics are to remain republics, they must also be defended by farmers willing to set aside the plow. Civic virtue for the pastoral republic must translate on the battlefield to civic militarism, because citizens were afforded liberty only as long as they were willing to fight for it. These themes are prevalent in many of the pastoral scenes throughout the Capitol, like the Cincinnatus painting and in other artworks. The Senate's bronze doors include the image of another American farmer soldier fighting a Hessian mercenary. The Senate chamber's east entry sports an engraving of a citizen soldier with one arm brandishing a sword and one hand leaning on his plow. Cincinnatus thus represented the spirit of the American citizen soldier, from commanders such as Washington and Putnam to the ideal of the nameless, average militiaman. The rotunda painting emphasizes the martial values necessary to defend the hard work of the colonists. Following Oglethorpe's piece, the next scenes are the Battle of Lexington, the reading of the Declaration of Independence, and the surrender of Cornwallis at Yorktown, the citizen soldiers fight the professional British armies at Lexington and win the victory over them at Yorktown 6 years later. The declaration scene is telling from another perspective. It does not show the writing or approval of the declaration in private chambers, but the reading of it in the public square. Adams, Jefferson, and Franklin are thus positioned amid the Philadelphia commoners, who receive the document with jubilation. The scene testifies to every republic's two essentials: the leadership of good men and the consent of a devoted, industrious citizenry. These two essentials were symbiotic. Sacrificial leaders like Putnam, Franklin, Jefferson, and Adams were supposed to have Kinkinadu's prowess and also his disdain for power. Unlike Washington in the preposterously divine and monarchic apotheosis of Washington in the top of the rotunda, these men are attired like and positioned among their fellow Republicans. They lead by the power of their own arguments and examples. Their fellow average Republicans consent to their leadership. Republics need wise and sacrificial leaders, but they also need a broad base of virtuous citizens. The soldier with the plow and sword above the Senate's east entry, and the soldier farmer fighting the Hessian mercenary in the Senate's bronze doors, represent this common citizen. He communes with the earth as a farmer during peacetime, but serves his republic as a citizen soldier during war. He is a man worthy of the leadership of Putnam, Adams, Jefferson, and Franklin. If Americans wish to take their country's history seriously, they must also take seriously the ancient republics that educated their framers. The capital is a complex structure that appropriately identifies the many historical strands that explain how the United States has gotten where it is. Some of these reflect the currents of the founding, and some of them indicate later tendencies that sailed against this current. Unless they wish to dismiss historical models entirely, modern Americans must choose from which models they will learn. Rome left the legacy of a republic that was imperfect, but also instructive and inspiring. Its pastoral culture cultivated virtue. Its constitution was well-balanced, enabling it to counter corruption. Its citizens were willing to defend and expand the liberties and laws of the republic. If America seeks a future inspired by the virtues of its past, then it must not merely derive inspiration from the founders. It must look to the Roman Republic that inspired them. Part 1. Farmers, Citizens, and Soldiers. Chapter 1. The Soldier's Farm. On 11 May 1778, a seemingly bizarre event concluded the harrowing winter at Valley Forge. George Washington and his soldiers watched a play. Due to a logistical maladministration that prevented much-needed materiel from reaching the troops, the winter of 1777-78 had given the Continental Army a test greater than any battlefield defeat, a fact evidenced by the atrocious casualty rates that far exceeded those incurred in any of the engagements throughout the war. Starvation, extreme weather, and disease had reduced fighting strength and morale. The play was designed to lift soldier spirits and remind them what they were fighting for. The selection was Joseph Addison's tragedy, Cato, which told the heroic stand of Cato the Younger against Julius Caesar. The play cast the first century Roman Republican as a liberty-loving icon of virtue and duty against Julius Caesar and his tyrannical bid to destroy the Republic. Cato represented the disappearing virtues of the Republican citizen soldier that were giving way to the opportunism and avarice of Caesar and his professional soldiers, more loyal to him than the dying Republic. Washington, the avid theatergoer, either chose or approved the play with the obvious intention of inspiring his own weary troops to fight the British tyrant and his professional armies currently occupying Philadelphia. Regardless of the historical veracity of the play, the story of a die-hard Republican sacrificing himself for Republican principles would have inspired the Continentals. The recruits at Valley Forge would have understood the sacrifices of Cato with his modest vision of a republic. The Continentals under Washington's command filled a vital role the militia did not by simply staying constituted regardless of the situation. However, these were still citizen soldiers. They had only recently enlisted, and the Continental Army's enlistments were notoriously ineffective. Originally, Congress had intended enlistments to last for the duration of the war, but this effort had largely failed by the winter of 1777. The soldiers in the militia always prioritized their farms and families first, and this same sentiment kept the Continental regulars from extended enlistments. None of these soldiers saw themselves as professionals, and all of them expected to return to their real work at their homes when the conflict concluded. It is difficult to determine whether American soldiers would find Cato's story inspiring today. On the one hand, they see themselves as defenders of a great republic. On the other hand, they would probably prefer the professionalism and martial prowess of a Julius Caesar. As members of a standing army themselves, they would also be more familiar with the discipline and training of Britain's standing army. Even National Guard and Reserve units today look less like citizen soldiers and more like professionals, given the number of deployments in recent years. The predominance of the citizen soldier in America is a thing of the past. Soldier-citizens or citizen-soldiers? When Army recruits in the United States begin basic training, it doesn't take long for them to understand they are being separated from society, removed from their families, friends, mobile phones, video games, and fast food chains. They begin an intense indoctrination that goes far beyond communing in mess halls, drilling at firing ranges, and engaging in tactical maneuvers. Drill sergeants and other trainers are primarily concerned with creating and maintaining a distinct Army culture. They consistently explain that their task is to break down the civilian so they can build the soldier. On behalf of the young recruits, they create a new family and a new moral order, complete with a warrior ethos, a code of honor, and long doctrinal lists of do's and don'ts. This is why soldiers often refer to their squads, platoons, and companies as families, and why many describe their military branch in ways others might describe their church. This kind of indoctrination extends to the downright silly. Common exercises like jumping jacks are renamed side straddle hops. Haircuts from the 1950s, like the flat top and the high and tight, are ubiquitous. Soldiers also become experts at the singular workout regimen of running around in circles of varying sizes until each individual becomes his own emaciated, marathon-running doppelganger. None of these quiddities has much to do with efficient military training. Soldiers do not shave their heads and faces for hygiene, run 5 miles a day for physical fitness, or speak the military dialect for superior tactical communication. Medical technology is now capable of managing beard-related bacteria. Physical training programs for athletes have proven that a predominantly running-based workout is ineffective for most activities. And the side straddle hop still involves jumping like fitness expert Jack LaLanne. Antiquated haircuts, peculiar dialects, and communal running perform the same function as church liturgies, national pledges of allegiance, fraternity hazing rituals, and the secret handshake. They create a culture that separates adherents from non-adherents. This cultural separation between civilians and soldiers has created a chasm in civil-military relations that widens year by year. In 2010, when the country was heavily involved in the War on Terror, only 3% of Americans polled cited the war in Afghanistan as an important issue, compared to 60% who cited the economy. Of those polled, 43% claimed they were following the economy closely, yet only 23% said they were doing the same with Afghanistan. Those perplexed by the growing gap between civilians and their armed forces should not be surprised. Why would most Americans care? No one will get drafted, the battles are far away, and deficit spending seems to preclude any economic consequences. Aren't most people safe in thinking, just leave it to the professionals? American military personnel complain that their civilian counterparts do not identify with their sacrifices. But do they have cause to complain? For professional soldiers, war is simply a job for which they often enjoy better pay and benefits than their counterparts of equal qualifications and education. They experience the horrors of war, but like trauma doctors, explosive handlers, and ICE truckers, they are compensated for their time and risks. Soldiers are also worshipped in ways that would have been unthinkable in the 1960s and 70s. Most businesses offer military discounts, and nearly any soldier who strays outside the base in uniform will receive a thank you for your service at the checkout line, or have his or her meal comped at a local restaurant. National holidays revere veterans and the fallen as national heroes in ways that are comparable to how Roman Catholics venerate saints. For the civilians, on the other hand, war is not something you experience. It is something you watch in a movie or read about in a book. They may oppose the war, feel mildly guilty that they didn't serve, idealize war stories, or just be glad they didn't have to do it themselves. Most praise the soldier for defending our freedom, which counts for nearly anything these days, including vaporizing those ever-threatening mule herders of the Hindu Kush with $65,000 automated missiles. An overwhelming majority of Americans have never served. Indeed, military participation rates have reached all-time lows in spite of the fact that America was recently locked in two wars and numerous minor engagements for over a decade. The American preference for specialization of labor has resulted in war being specialized. In 1953, Arthur A. Eckert predicted that the American conception of a citizen army would become obsolete, because the new Cold War military looked more like the standing armies that earned so much loathing in past centuries. Military historians were quick to adapt, however, hailing the soldier-citizen as the new Minuteman. Soldier-citizens make up a much smaller percentage of the population. They have spent decades in the military and supposedly exemplify virtues such as honor, courage, and loyalty. However, unlike the citizen soldier, they are defined by their commitment to military culture. As the title swapping indicates, the soldier comes first and the citizen is second. The question naturally raised by all this is whether citizen armies as conceived by the ancients will ever be possible again. Americans may produce films about the Greek city-state's stand against Persia, but long gone is the Minuteman who shared features with his Athenian counterpart. News of a Persian invasion in 490 BC prompted a mustering of farmers who marched to Marathon, fought a battle, and then returned home to farm some more. In the decades following Marathon, Athens recruited higher percentages of its citizens to fight, which was a tendency bolstered by its naval activities. Even poor Athenian citizens could serve on a trireme. Sparta, on the other hand, represented the opposite end of the recruitment spectrum. Approximately 9 out of every 10 men in Spartan society were either free, non-citizen locals, or state-owned slaves called helots, whose chief function was to maintain the agricultural economy of the Spartan citizens. With the farming left to the second class or the subjugated, full citizens were free to participate in a unique military culture that made Sparta the most formidable polis in Hellas. Spartiates were the soldier citizens of the ancient world, who knew comparatively little about economics, farming, and civilian life. In this way, American soldiering increasingly looks more like the Spartan soldier citizen than the Athenian citizen soldier. Who will do the killing? Since war doesn't seem to be going away anytime soon, cultures must still find an institutional arrangement that allocates war fighting. Which is better? To play the role of Athens and partially dehumanize more of the population by making them part-time citizen soldiers, or to play the role of Sparta and completely dehumanize a small portion by creating a warrior class of professional soldiers? Ultimately, all polities must decide which they prefer. The decision is informed by a matrix of cultural ideals. Is soldiering better than vocations such as farming? Is courage in battle superior to hard work on the farm? Should politics and war involve as many citizens as possible or as few as possible? How warlike should a population be? One of the reasons I focus on Rome here is that it answered these questions by forging a middle way between the Athenian and Spartan preferences. It made its amateurs incredibly proficient. Regardless of how cultures sort out these ideals, war is a nasty business. In the ancient world, successful soldiers became proficient at slashing metal implements into the skulls, bones, and joints of their enemies so that they could crush or hack off arms, legs, and heads. They used arrows, spears, javelins, and swords as thrusting tools that would cause blood to gush, internal organs to burst out of the body, and the internal anatomy to shut down. After destroying human life in these gruesome ways, soldiers ending a siege would often loot property, rape defenseless women, and kill their children. If a commander could halt the rapaciousness of his soldiers, the remaining population would be enslaved. In the course of more comprehensive rampages, valuable property would be removed wholesale. Beautiful architectural feats would be leveled, and settlements would be burned to the ground. Surrounding croplands that had not been damaged by raids would have been used to supply the armies, whether en route or encamped for a siege. Killing, destroying, and enslaving strip out every ounce of humanity from both subject and object. The dehumanizing may only last for the moment of the death blow, the instant of the fire lighting, or the transaction of the slave sale. But most of the time, its effects linger. Such dehumanizing acts were the norm in the ancient world, and it is not altogether different in war zones today. William Tecumseh Sherman was right in 1880 when he declared to American Civil War veterans and rosy-cheeked Academy cadets that there is many a boy here today who looks on war as all glory, but, boys, it is all hell. Sherman's tactics in the war made him uniquely suited to understand the inhumanity soldiers inflict on humans in warfare. The century following Sherman's pronouncement demonstrated the hellish nature of humans and hindered claims to moral progress. If the 20th century showed anything about the human propensity for destruction, it was that what took the ancients days, weeks, and sometimes years to accomplish could be achieved by the moderns in seconds. Take the World War II atomic attacks as an example. At 8:15 a.m. on 6 August 1945, Hiroshima was full of life and industry. At 8:16 a.m., most of it was gone. It took less than a minute for the bomb named Little Boy to reach its detonation point after being dropped from the Enola Gay, and less than a second to obliterate everything in downtown Hiroshima. Hiroshima and Nagasaki inaugurated a new era in warfare. Teams of scientists, highly placed politicians, military administrators, and 12 aircraft crewmen achieved their tactical goals at Hiroshima in moments. 70,000 were killed. A strategic city was incapacitated. A vital military-industrial center was neutralized. Compare Hiroshima with events in the Second Punic War between Rome and Carthage. It took Hannibal's soldiers the entire day to hack up to 70,000 legionnaires to death at the Battle of Cannae. It took Marcellus 2 years to break through the defenses of Syracuse and capture the town. And it took Scipio Africanus 5 years to neutralize the industrial and military capabilities of Carthaginian Iberia. The contrasts between Hiroshima and the Second Punic War also highlight differences in civic participation. Hannibal, Marcellus, and Scipio required tens of thousands of soldiers capable of slashing, stabbing, and killing other human beings. The post-atomic age only requires a handful of scientists, administrators, and military specialists. Soldier citizens may eventually be replaced by military technocrats. Teams of technological specialists that manipulate the course of wars by a series of button pushes. These trends toward specialization must be confronted, and one way to do that is by reflecting on the history of civil-military relations. A good starting point for this is an examination of the Republican ethos in the Roman world. The average family in Roman Italy sent multiple military-aged males to fight in the war against Carthage, and even the mercenary-hiring Carthaginians were required to arm themselves when the war reached Africa. Killing is much easier and more specialized today, with average citizens in developed countries spectating war on the sidelines, if they even watch it at all. This modern trend may be viewed by many as more just, more efficient, and more free. However, it is historically less republican. In the ancient republican ethos, the act of taking up arms for the public good made a citizen virtuous. That citizen was willing to sacrifice his own humanity in killing and possibly even in dying. The citizen who is patriotic, brave, and worthy of a leading place in the state, Cicero writes, will dedicate himself unreservedly to his country. He will surely cleave to justice and honor so closely that he will submit to any loss, however heavy, rather than be untrue to them, and will face death itself rather than renounce them. Livy believed that the Roman Republic earned its liberty because the citizenry as a whole learned to manifest this sort of virtue. They had been tempered by the pledges of wife and children and love of the very place and soil which had firmly united their aspirations, at the same time that their leaders rejected a king in favor of magistrates whose terms and scope of power were limited. This love united them to oust a tyrant and erect a republic. Romans were convinced that republican government could only maintain its cohesion if each citizen actively defended this object of his love. The virtuous life must not merely be personal and private, but public. And one of the clearest manifestations of public virtue was when citizens united into a citizen army. So, what is a citizen army? A citizen army, whether ancient or modern, is a marshaling of soldiers designed to defend a polity that is somehow subject to them and represents their interests. This is most readily seen in the citizen soldier's role in authorizing campaigns as part of a legitimate political process. Citizens fight not merely for a governing elite and its interests, but for their own lives, profits, and well-being. Soldiers' loyalty belongs to the public good, rather than commanders, which could lead to client or private armies, or themselves, which could lead to mercenary armies. Most importantly, while they exercise allegiance to the state, they nurture prior obligations to their communities.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.